Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome AP President Dr. Melba J.T. Vasquez.
Friends, colleagues, and honored guests, as APA President, it is my great pleasure to welcome you to Washington, D.C., and to the 119th Annual Meeting of the American Psychological Association, the oldest and largest psychological organization in the world. Before we begin the program, I'd like to thank Funkadelic for their wonderful performance. What a wonderful way to kick off the opening session. The head of Funkadelic, Rahul Sharma, is a psychologist, and he and his very talented group have energized audiences at the Multicultural Summit, as well as at this conference 2 years ago, and so some of you may recognize their music. I wanted to share their unique sound with you this evening. So please join me again in giving Funkadelic an enthusiastic round of applause. On behalf of the Board of Directors, the Council of Representatives, the Board of Convention Affairs, and Central Office staff, we are delighted that you are here, and we look forward to a most interesting and enjoyable 2011 annual meeting. Now, you may know that today is President Barack Obama's 50th birthday. Yeah. So we invited the President and First Lady Michelle Obama to come here with us tonight to celebrate. They thought Chicago might be a better place, but we tried. As you can see from the convention materials, the presentations this year are diverse and intriguing. In particular, please note the plenary and presidential sessions highlighted in the front of the convention program, and I encourage you to sample something new this year. There's so much to choose from. In addition to the vast array of substantive program sessions, you won't want to miss out on some exciting special events that I'm going to point out. APA's evening at the museum. Psychologists are having our own special event on Friday evening at one of Washington's newest and most popular museums. This ticketed event will give members an insider's view of this interactive museum of news with behind-the-scenes views of how and why news is made. And tickets are still available at the special events booth in the registration area. APA's fabulous Food Truck Festival on Saturday from 11:30 a.m. until 2 p.m. will be held so that you can sample some of the best taste treats from Washington's inventive food trucks while enjoying live music. The festival will be conveniently located across the street from the Convention Center in Mount Vernon Square. Speed Mentoring, a very popular event, is back for its third year and once again is a sold-out event. It's a fast-paced opportunity for graduate students and early career psychologists to interact face-to-face with more experienced psychologists. The opportunity to connect face-to-face with friends and colleagues is one of the best things about convention and why so many psychologists choose to attend. We're very excited to bring you the APA Science Showcase, where you can experience psychological research in an entirely new way. We have live stage demonstrations and audience participation. The Science Showcase features examples of fascinating research with everyday benefits for the public. The $3,000 first prize for best demonstration goes to Michael Prue of Queen Mary University, London, for presenting a system that enables the blind to see with audio signals. And I believe Dr. Prue is in the audience. Are you here, Dr. Prue? Would you stand? Yay. Thank you. Additional demonstrations include Beth Carlin's in-home feedback system, which helps people to conserve energy usage, and David Schroeder's presentation of a fatigue assessment test, which allows workers in high-intensity professions to measure alertness. Demonstrations take place tomorrow and Saturday at the Science Showcase stage near the registration area. For the first time, you can earn unlimited CE credits for a single fee, choosing from nearly 300 continuing education sessions. All of these are held in the Convention Center and are identified by a special logo in the convention program. We've worked with the Committee on Early Career Psychologists to develop family-friendly options, including a family resource room where parents can bring their children to relax, enjoy a book or game, and spend some quality time together. APA continues to expand its use of technology, and a special new enhancement for convention attendees is the APA Convention mobile application that puts the entire program on your iPad or smartphone. Now, I've heard people say that that is very cool. Now you can leave behind that big book, but still access the full schedule, exhibitors, and presenters. So stay connected and learn what's happening across the convention via the convention blog, LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter. And you won't want to miss the technology exhibit in the exhibit hall. Here you can explore the latest in technological tools and techniques for psychologists through expert demonstrations, hands-on opportunities, and 15-minute topical discussions. Finally, don't miss the fun digital photo booth in the exhibit hall. Capture your convention experience with a candid photo of you and your friends at the digital photo booth. Watch the digital signage in the convention hall lobbies for your picture. Whatever you choose to attend, I hope that you have a wonderful time at the 2011 convention in this extraordinary city, home to our headquarters building. My presidential convention theme is social justice and how it can be supported by psychological science. My presidential address tomorrow afternoon is on social justice, and there are a variety of presidential program sessions that will focus on immigration, discrimination and diversity, and educational disparities. I hope you will join me. I appreciate the diversity of APA, and I know that even though we do not always agree on everything, we do share a collective goal to promote a thriving discipline. As APA president, I have been given a unique opportunity to advance our shared goal by bringing the strongest science and practice to contribute to some of the most critical issues facing society today. As president, I also realize that I have a limited amount of time to accomplish these goals. Therefore, I targeted three presidential task forces about issues that I care about deeply and to which psychology has much to contribute, much information: immigration, discrimination and diversity, and educational disparities. I'm also working with APA governance to develop guidelines for telepsychology and to adopt a resolution on the effectiveness of psychotherapy. The APA Presidential Task Force on Immigration, chaired by Carola Suarez Orozco, is charged with developing an evidence-based report on the psychological factors related to the immigration experience. The report describes in broad strokes this diverse population and then addresses the psychological experience of immigration, considering factors that impede and facilitate adjustment. Specifically, they review the recent theoretical and empirical literature on immigration with the goals of raising awareness about this growing but poorly understood population, deriving evidence-informed recommendations for the provision of psychological services for the immigrant origin population, and providing recommendations for the advancement of training, research, and policy efforts for immigrant children, adults, older adults, and families. The work of my Presidential Task Force on Preventing Discrimination and Promoting Diversity, chaired by James Jones, focuses on two issues: the enormous toll on human capital exacted by systematic biases, stereotypes, and discrimination, and the fact of an ever-expanding diversity of the population of the United States and its expression across all segments of society. The task force report reflects how strong psychological science can be implemented and evaluated in the workplace, courts, schools, the media, in families, and in our communities. The aim is to make the report accessible in both written and a variety of other media formats to researchers, educators, students, and policymakers, as well as to advocacy groups and lay audiences interested in the science of discrimination and the nurturance of diversity. Another presidential task force on educational disparities, chaired by Steve Quintana, is charged with identifying what psychology has to say about the causes, the sequelae, as well as policy and programs to reduce educational disparities, especially for poor and or racial and ethnic minority students. Each of these projects is designed to highlight psychologists' scientific base, our understanding of behavior, and the value the discipline can bring to improving the health and well-being of individuals and communities. And I would like to thank the chairs and all the members of my presidential task forces for generously sharing of their time and expertise to work on these important projects. Would you help me express appreciation for them? Now I would like to introduce some honored guests at this year's convention. So as you're introduced, would you please stand and would you please hold all applause until the end? Please join me in welcoming some of our colleagues from around the world, including a delegation from the Mexican Psychological Association. Would they please stand and please hold your applause and remain standing? Earlier today, APA signed a Memorandum of Understanding with the Mexican Psychological Association, which allows for more collaboration between our associations. I would also like to welcome the delegation from the Norwegian Psychological Association, so they would also please stand. And we want to once again express condolences from the entire APA family for the horrific terrorist attack in Norway. We value the overwhelming response from the Norwegian people to respond to this tragedy with increased democracy, dialogue, and open discussion. And we applaud the efforts of the mental health workers to support this resilience. Thank you very much. I would now like to welcome some additional honored guests. I'd like the president of the District of Columbia Psychological Association, DCPA, Dr. Stephen Bowles, a psychologist and a colonel in the U.S. Army, to please stand. And also a delegation from the Council of the National Psychology Associations for the Advancement of Ethnic Minority Interest, including the Asian American Psychological Association and their president, Dr. Gordon Nagayama Hall. The Association of Black Psychologists and their president, Dr. Cheryl Grills, the National Latino Psychological Association and their president, Dr. Edward Delgado Romero, the Society of Indian Psychologists and their president, Dr. Pamela Dieters, and APA's Division 45, the Society for the Psychological Study of Ethnic Minority Issues and their president, Dr. Jean Lau Chin. I would also like to recognize the two newly elected members of the Board of Directors. As of yesterday, we discovered that Dr. Josephine D. Johnson and Susan H. McDaniel will be joining us, as will the APEG's liaison to the board, Ali Matu. Would you please stand? I am delighted to recognize those who have contributed so much, so generously, to the American Psychological Foundation. Their contributions will help keep psychology vibrant for future generations. Would you please stand? As we all know, APA is a membership organization, and we depend on our members who volunteer their time, energy, and expertise in order to strengthen the association. And I'd like to recognize some of these individuals and groups today. So again, please hold your applause until the end. So I'd like to begin by introducing my colleagues in APA, the 2011 Board of Directors, including immediate past President Carol Goodhart and President-elect Suzanne Bennett Johnson. So if you would stand and please remain standing. It is my great honor to introduce the APA past presidents, the Council of Representatives. You would stand and remain standing. The chairs of the boards and committees and the Board of Convention Affairs. And would all the APA past presidents please stand as well. I would also like to take a personal moment to thank all of you who have been so helpful to me before and during my presidential year. You are too many to name, but I do want to give a shout out to my Austin and Denver contingency. You know who you are, if you would please stand. Also, I come from a very large family and have a couple of representatives in the audience. My niece, Elisa Vasquez, who will begin her counseling psychology doctoral program at the University of California, Santa Barbara this fall. My mother, Ophelia Vasquez Filo, who is an amazing, outstanding woman in her own right. And my incredible partner and my best friend, Jim Miller, my favorite consultant as well. Thank you very much. I've obviously introduced a large number of dedicated people already, but even in this group, the person I'm about to introduce is extra special. His excellent work has kept APA on track and moving forward. I'm delighted to present APA's Chief Executive Officer and Executive Vice President, Dr. Norman Anderson, who will welcome you in behalf of the association. Dr. Anderson has been APA CEO since 2003. As CEO, he oversees both the corporate and professional management of the association, which includes approximately 150,000 members and affiliates, a staff of about 600, and a budget of more than $115 million a year. Norman has also taken the lead in developing, communicating, and implementing APA's first ever strategic plan. Please welcome Dr. Anderson.
Thank you, Melba, and good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Washington, D.C. On behalf of the APA Central Office and the nearly 600 staff members who work for you, I want to welcome you to our nation's capital. Hosting our APA convention in D.C. is always special because, as many of you know, this is APA's hometown. This is where our headquarters is located. APA was incorporated in D.C. in 1925, and we have maintained headquarters here since the late 1940s. APA has had a close and long-standing partnership with the city. With a significant tax incentive in the form of a real estate tax abatement from the City Council, APA committed to constructing our present headquarters building next to Union Station, a neighborhood that was very much underdeveloped at the time. Our commitment to build in this neighborhood greatly facilitated the revitalization of that area. And in the mid-1990s, APA further improved the area with the construction of a second commercial office building just one block away. Hosting the convention here in D.C. represents a unique opportunity for you to actually visit the central office if you haven't before. So on Friday, August 5th, we will be hosting tours of our headquarters building every half hour from 10 a.m. until 3 p.m. We're located not far from here in the Capitol Hill area, so if you get a chance, please come by, take a tour, and meet some of our excellent staff. You can pick up information about the tours at the registration area and at the membership booth. If you decide to take a tour, please remember to bring your convention badges for security purposes. Finally, as you know, there are always so many exciting things happening within the association. So just to give you a sense of some of those things, and how we serve you, our members, and how we serve the public, we've prepared a short video that we hope you will enjoy. Again, welcome to DC, and have a wonderful meeting.
It has been another busy and productive year for the American Psychological Association. Membership in the organization remains strong, and public awareness of psychology as a discipline and a science continues to grow. APA remains at the forefront of the field, advancing psychological research, education, and practice while addressing the needs of an ever-changing psychology workforce. APA is proud to have begun implementing its first strategic plan, giving the organization even more clarity on what lies ahead.
It's been a really exciting year at APA as we've started to implement our first ever strategic plan and move the association toward accomplishing its goals. One of the proposed initiatives has to do with understanding psychology's workforce to really collect data to better understand what the public needs from psychology and how psychology can better meet those needs. Another thing we're doing this year is something called the Good Governance Project, where we've convened a group of our members to make recommendations about our governance structure. The question really is, do we have the right governance structure for APA for the 21st century? Another proposed initiative has to do with expanding our capability to produce treatment guidelines, that is, to be able to better disseminate evidence-based approaches in psychology.
APA is also leading the way in the shift to a team-based, interdisciplinary approach to science and healthcare.
Both the science and healthcare worlds are moving to team-based work, that is, team-based interdisciplinary science and team-based interdisciplinary care. We want our members to be able to work in those environments, so we're convening task forces to help us examine and actually be leaders in fostering team-based interdisciplinary research involving psychologists, but also team-based healthcare involving psychologists as part of healthcare teams.
A big part of APA's strategic plan revolves around communicating APA's message to members and the public. The organization has expanded its use of electronic communication to inform and engage its members, and social media platforms like Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn that have become a part of our everyday lives have become an important way for APA to get its message out.
You know, these days, social media is very important in society, and APA is using its resources to help our members engage with each other in social media spaces, but also create those social media spaces for the general public to educate them more about psychology.
APA continues to have a strong presence on Capitol Hill, making sure the voice of the psychologist is heard in Washington. Hundreds of APA members came to Washington throughout the year to advocate for psychology before Congress and federal agencies. Last year, APA was focused on helping to get health care reform passed, and this year, the organization has been working on its implementation. Working to eliminate health care disparities has also been an important goal of the organization.
One of the big public health challenges facing our country is health disparities, that is, differences in health outcomes between various racial and ethnic groups in the United States. To address this issue, we're convening a group of experts to examine and make recommendations about evidence-based approaches to actually help eliminate health disparities.
Disparities in educational outcomes is another area that needs psychology's expertise. Understanding these growing disparities and working to reduce them is one of the three presidential initiatives of APA President Dr. Melba Vasquez.
Society benefits when we have a well-educated populace. And I've always been interested in education. I was a school teacher before I became a psychologist. And I learned recently that the educational gap among racial, ethnic minorities, among poor people, is getting larger. So that is a big concern.
Another presidential initiative delves into the immigrant experience in America. Psychology recognizes the important role immigrants play in American society and is trying to better understand the psychological effects of immigration.
immigration is such a major part of the American experience, and psychology has a lot to say about what today's immigrant experience is like. So my task force members are looking at the evidence base in regard to the experience of immigrants, especially as it relates to the experience of acculturation, the experience of discrimination, how both federal and state policies in regard to immigration are affecting their lives.
Discrimination, prejudice, and bias are the focus of another presidential initiative examining both cause and effect.
All my life, I have been interested in the experience of discrimination and prejudice and bias. And so I appointed a task force of people who've been doing psychological research for decades about the experience of prejudice, discrimination, and bias. We wanted to pull together cutting-edge research about understanding what causes those attitudes and behaviors and the impact that they have on targets of prejudice, racism, discrimination, homophobia, and so on.
The APA directorates, education, science, practice, and public interests, are hard at work for you, the APA members. They continue to be important conduits through which member needs are addressed, governance-created projects are completed, and psychology and psychological expertise are brought to the public, policymakers, and the news media. The work of APA's governance groups and directorates sets standards for psychology education, research, and practice, advocates for funding for psychological research, advocates for consumer access to quality mental and behavioral health care, applies psychology to human welfare, and educates the public about the breadth and value of the discipline. Be sure to visit their information booths outside of the exhibit hall in the convention center for more information about the work of the directorates. APA is excited to share many new products with members this year. As the world's leading publisher of psychological scholarship, APA continues to create new and better electronic platforms as a means for psychologists, students, and others to access the discipline scholarship. In 2011, for the first time, APA journal articles were published online first, creating access to new research within as few as 30 days after an article is accepted for publication through APA's Psych Articles database. APA journal articles are also now available through a mobile app. And in September, APA will release two new databases to serve the field. Psych Tests, a research database that provides access to complete psychological tests, measures, scales, and other assessments, and Psych Therapy, a database of streaming therapy demonstrations featuring clinicians working with participants. APA will continue to provide critical resources for members to fulfill the organization's vision to excel as a valuable, effective, and influential organization, advancing psychology as a scientific discipline. The world needs psychology, and psychology has more work to do. Thanks for helping us serve you, and welcome to Washington and the 119th Annual APA Convention.
Thank you, Norman. It is now my honor to introduce the first very worthy recipient of the APA Award for Outstanding Lifetime Contributions to Psychology, Dr. Florence Denmark. Florence Denmark is the Robert Scott Pace Distinguished Research Professor Emerita in Residence at Pace University. Dr. Denmark is a social psychologist who has published extensively on the psychology of women and gender. She has also long been a force in advancing psychology internationally. She was the 88th president of the American Psychological Association, as well as president of numerous other psychology organizations. I am personally lucky to be among many, many, many who have benefited from her generous mentoring from afar at times. Dr. Denmark, I would like to note some highlights from that big old award over there. Not going to read the whole thing, just a few things. You have always held that public service is the most important part of being a leader in psychology and have devoted yourself to this pursuit. As a professor and department chair, you have fostered research on gender issues and human rights and have written many books and articles addressing aspects of this work. Those who know you describe you as doing all you do with grace and leadership. As the head of the APA team at the United Nations, you've been an outstanding leader for the first ever Psychology Day held at the United Nations. And because of your dynamic personal leadership style, you have made inroads in bringing vital concerns to the attention of the United Nations personnel. Congratulations, Dr. Denmark.
Thank you, ma'am. I can't tell you how thrilled I am. It's nice to be on this side of the audience, but because usually I've been out there a lot, but now it's up here. No, but this is really a very, very exciting time to get that award. And although it's a lifetime achievement, I'm still living, so I have more to go, more to do. I do want to mention a few people. I'm delighted to have so many friends in the audience, and I just will, including colleagues from PACE, from various aspects of my life who are here. And I do want to mention some family members. My son, Richard Denmark, my stepson Michael Westner, and my daughter-in-law Josephine Tan, and they are very special to me. And the only thing I really am sorry about is that my husband, who many of you know, Bob Westner, died last year, and he would have been jumping with joy, I think, at this occasion. So I do miss him. He was my soulmate, and I'm sorry he can't be here. I do want to mention that, to me, I think this is particularly a great time for me. And thank you, Melba, and also my James Jones, who is also going to receive this award. We go back a long way together. We're both very involved with public interest issues. And that's why I think this is extra special, because I will continue to do all I can, not only to work on behalf of women, but young psychologists. I'm involved with the field of aging now, and I served on various committees of BIAPI, and including women, aging, and I guess I'm always ready to say CLGC, that's what it was before we added the B and the T on that committee. So I'm glad they were added, but it wasn't there when I was on the committee. But I think if there's anyone I love to mentor, and I would welcome anyone, and the young psychologists and the students, give me a call or email me or something, because I'll be there to help anyone I can. Thank you very much.
It's not as heavy as it looks. It is now my pleasure to present a second APA award for lifetime contributions to psychology to an equally worthy recipient, Dr. James M. Jones. James Jones is a professor of psychology at the University of Delaware. He was also the director of APA's Minority Fellowship Program. And I have to tell you, as one of the first recipients in the fellowship, I have benefited from the process of socialization into the APA, which first Dr. Delmas Taylor and then Dr. James Jones provided to fellow recipients. So here I am. Dr. Jones' main area of interest is UCR, or the Universal Context of Racism. A second area of work explores the implications of TRIOs, a psychological worldview that combines African-inspired processes of time, rhythm, improvisation, orality, and spirituality. Dr. Jones is also interested in the social psychology of time. Dr. Jones, I would like to read highlights from your award. As director of the APA Minority Fellowship Program for nearly 30 years, you were inspirational to our field and an exemplar of dedicated service. You have contributed to the program's renown as one of the most successful for ethnic and racial minority researchers and service providers in the history of federally funded programs. Your integrity, cultural sensitivity, foresight, and strong leadership have enriched the education and training of generations of racial and ethnic minority psychologists. Through the Minority Fellowship Program, you secured millions of dollars of federal grant money. Moreover, you have been a major author and researcher in the area of prejudice and discrimination. Congratulations, Dr. Jones.
A little bit too eager to get my prize. Thank you very much, Dr. J.T., Melba J.T. Vasquez, Melba. It's very special to share the stage tonight with the CEO, the president, the keynote speaker, and my other honoree, because it reflects, I think, a very important exemplification of how diversity in psychology makes us a better discipline and a better field of study. I'm especially happy to share this evening with my beloved family. They're waiting for this. My wife, Olive, who has always encouraged me, supported me, and loved me for every one of these lifetime years. My daughters, Shelley, Hairston Jones, and her husband, Keith, and their son, my grandson, Lowell James Hairston, who is a handsome, precious, fearsome lacrosse-playing grandson and bike-riding buddy. Nashi Jones Cantrell, my other daughter, and her husband Maurice, who's sort of takes care of the family organization. She works for Microsoft and she knows how to do all that stuff. I'm very happy to be able to share this with them. There are many people who I want to thank. I can't thank them all, obviously, by name, but I do want to just mention my mentors: Norm Henderson, who was my mentor at Oberlin College, Tom Shipley at Temple, and at Yale, Bob Abelson and Chuck Kiesler, and Chuck is the one who brought me to APA. They taught me how to think rigorously about psychology, and it's been my approach to everything I've done ever since. The Minority Fellowship Program family, beginning with Dalmas Taylor, who's deceased now, but who set the model for the program, the fellows, who of course are the heart of it, the advisory committee to help us make it work, and the many colleagues in departments of psychology around the country, going back to 1975, 76, when departments were very different than they are now. At least they were certainly a different color. They support us unfailingly and generously, and I really appreciate that. My colleagues at APA, who over 28 years of being there, really supported what we did and how we approached things. When I applied for PhD programs in 1965, I did so because I wanted to be Kenneth B. Clark. I did. I had read an article in the New York Times about his work, the How You Act work in Harlem, and I thought, if I got a PhD, maybe I could do something significant like that. So I went to study experimental social psychology, and surprisingly learned from my colleagues that, one, race was not an experimental variable in social psychology, and two, our science was more interested in variables than in people. Neither of these views would stand up today, but that was the climate in which I launched my career as a social psychologist. I was given an opportunity to write about race, which I did in Prejudice and Racism in 1972, and I wanted to talk about race from my own personal black experience and explore the core, which in my mind was culture. I introduced the concept of cultural racism that identified the intersection of power, racialized beliefs and antipathies, systemic institutional practices, and their impact on social inequality and injustice. The second volume of Prejudice and Racism showed that, in 1997, showed that how much more we knew about racism, but how little we knew about how to diminish it. And further showed that diversity in the U.S. population was presenting new challenges that an evolving psychology was increasingly challenged to address. I came to APA in 1977, and over the period of some 28 years, we supported nearly 1,500 doctoral students who've earned their degrees in psychology. Many of them are here, not only Melba, Shell Grills, president of ABSci, Fred Leong. I mean, I can't begin to try to name everybody, but really significant figures in psychology who reflect, I think, well on what we tried to do. In 1975, 5.4% of PhDs in psychology were awarded to ethnic and racial minorities. In 2008, that number was 23.7. That's a significant increase. They weren't all recipients of the APA Minority Fellowship, but I think the spirit of the fellowship resided in all of them. In 1981, ethnic and racial minority faculty were around 5%, and in 2010, they were 15% in departments of psychology. Again, a significant increase, not enough, but really significant. And among the APA membership, just since 1987, it has doubled from 5 to 10%. These are not overwhelming numbers, but they do suggest that sustained effort can really make a difference. I served as the first executive director for public interest, during which we published articles on abortion in the journal Science, which I think was very significant and pivotal. We did special issues of the American Psychologist on homelessness and HIV and AIDS. And our aim was to bring psychological science to bear on public interest issues and to help shape social policy along the way, and I think we did a pretty good job. Over the past 40 years, I have seen significant changes in the nature of psychology. I always argued that diversifying psychology in this way would not only provide opportunities for those who had little, but would ultimately make psychology a better discipline. I have no doubt that both are true. Woody Allen says, 95% of life is just showing up. I've been showing up for what has become a lifetime, and I am truly honored to be recognized for whatever role I have played in making psychology a better discipline, more inclusive discipline, and one that matters in our society. Thank you, Madam President, for this great, great honor.
Now we have arrived at a highlight of this evening's program, the keynote address. I am pleased to present eminent social psychologist Dr. Claude Steele. Dr. Steele was Columbia University's 21st provost, as well as a professor of psychology. He received his PhD from Ohio State University and has also received numerous honorary degrees, including those from the University of Chicago, Yale, and Princeton. Before joining Columbia, he was a faculty member at Stanford University, where he will return September 1st as Dean of the School of Education. Dr. Steele is a recognized leader in the field of social psychology for his commitment to the systematic application of social science to problems of major societal significance. He is best known for his landmark work on stereotype threat, and this evening he will speak about his findings and their implications. Immediately after this session, you can purchase and have him sign a copy of his book, Whistling Vivaldi and Other Clues to How Stereotypes Affect Us and What We Can Do. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Steele.
Thank you. Thank you, Melba. It's a real delight to be here. I was counting up the years. I think the first time I came to an APA was 43 years ago. So it's a place that feels like home to me. It's an extremely important audience for me. I feel it's a gratifying and a memorable honor to be able to speak to you today. So I much appreciate it. I want to talk and give an overview of the research that I've done with my students and colleagues over the years, looking at the impact of stereotypes on our psychological functioning and maybe in particular on our intellectual functioning. There are going to be two subtexts to this talk that I think are probably worth pointing out at this point, because I think they're great lessons to me that I got from this doing this research, and I want to pass them on. The first is an appreciation for the power of the social context on our psychological functioning. Reared as a psychologist, I tend to psychologize and to think of everything important as something that happens inside the head, or at least inside the emotions, or something of that sort. And one of the lessons that I got from doing this research, and I hope that you'll pick up on too, is the impact of the social context on things that we think are rather independent of it. Things like, for example, intellectual performance. The second subtext that I want to stress at the outset is the value of working on practical problems for getting at and discovering basic psychological processes. I think that has been a real overriding lesson for me, that if you're looking for good ideas about theory, it's good to start with a practical problem and to try to understand it, and that way work backwards toward basic psychological processes. And sometimes you start with I'd like to think in this case, with a very specific problem, but you wind up with a process that holds for everybody. That's true for a broad sweep of people. So that's the second theme. I'll begin with a description of the practical problem from which this research began. Then I'll go into a theory of attempt to explain it. But it began when I moved to the University of Michigan from the University of Washington in the mid-1980s, and I was put, as is the good fate of many minority faculty, on the recruitment and retention committee. And as I sat down on that first day of the committee, we were handed out a lot of material, and on the top of the stack of material was a set of data that I'll show you now. These are not exactly the same data, but they're a figurative. Do I have my pointer? Or did I lose my pointer? I think I don't have it. In fact, I know I don't have it. Maybe it's in the green room. I have been told so many times by the people backstage, don't lose that pointer. And the first thing I do is lose that thing. So I have to apologize. Here we go. Thank you.
What you see there is the grades, the average grades that students got at the University of Michigan for their whole time there, their overall grade point average, graphed out as a function of their SAT scores or the ACT scores that they had when they entered the University of Michigan. And what you get when you look for all students is a very typical line that will surprise nobody in this audience, that students that come in with somewhat better preparation for college as measured by those standardized tests tend to get better grades overall. So starting on the low end, they get the grades get higher as the entering SAT scores and ACT scores get higher. What was interesting to me is not that, but the second fact, I did find one. Thank you, Melville. Now I have a surplus of pointers. The graph that I saw broke down, gave two lines, one for all the students at the University of Michigan, the first line I just showed you, and the second was for African-American students only, and here's what that line looked like. And that was very interesting, fascinating to me, that at every level of SAT score that students entered the University of Michigan with, African-American students were getting lower grades than other students at Michigan, even though they had the same skills, at least as measured by these standardized tests. That was a surprise. If you told me that African-American students had got lower grade averages than white students, I wouldn't have been that surprised. After all, race is still such a factor in educational opportunity in this society that even among students who are qualified enough to have been admitted to the University of Michigan, you wouldn't be surprised if, on average, white students, reflecting some of those advantages, might have gotten higher grade averages than African-American students. But what these data were showing, and this is what was a real puzzle, is that even when you equate for preparation, at least using these tests as a measure of preparation, even when you equate for that, black students were still getting lower grades than other students at with their same level of preparation. This meant something else had to be going on. There was something that wasn't understood about this phenomenon of underperformance. Very quickly, we found that the same thing happened to women at the University of Michigan in advanced math courses there. Not in entry-level math courses, but advanced math courses. And then we found out, of course, as many of you in the audience probably know, this is an absolutely national phenomenon. It's known as underperformance. Groups whose abilities, intellectual abilities, are negatively stereotyped in the larger society, African-American students, Latinos, women in math, Native Americans, tend to, in some subsequent level of schooling, get lower grades, lower performance than even their test scores would predict. Why would that happen? Okay. Keep that puzzle in mind, because I hope over the course of the talk you'll be convinced that we've got at least part of the answer. And at the end of the talk, I want to show you what can happen if you try some of the remedies that I'm going to suggest for treating the problem that this puzzle led to. But first, I want to give you an overview of our theory, of our explanation of this phenomenon, and you'll, I hope, see that it is a phenomenon that not only affects these students, but that everybody in the room experiences, I think, probably on a daily basis. The theory, the explanation, starts out with a definition of social identity, which is a very standard textbook definition. Social identity is that part of our personal identity, our sense of who we are, that comes from our group memberships and the social categories to which we belong. Our age, our sex, our race, religion, profession, ethnicity, nationality, political affiliation, mental health status, all of these things count as social identities. And the major point in the theory is an explanation of what makes some of these social identities more important than others. And in answering that question, we come to a simple notion of identity contingencies. That is, things you have to deal with because you have the identity in particular situations. If you don't have to deal with anything because you have a particular feature or characteristic, the argument pushed to its farthest length implication here is that that feature would never rise to the level of a social identity, something that has a real impact on how you function and think and, and behave in society. But if you do have to deal with things because of it, then that feature becomes something like an identity. I use in this book, I try to test some of these ideas out against my own autobiography. So I ask myself the question, when was the first time I realized I was black? When did I realize that? And to the best and to the extent that one can trust one's memory, you know, we psychologists have been pretty humbled about the validity of memory. But to the extent that, we can trust it, I think it was coming home from school on the last day of school in the third grade in an African-American community, and we're talking about what we're going to do in the summertime, and it comes up that we're not going to be allowed to go swim in the swimming pool that's about three blocks outside of our community. We're not going to be allowed to go there except on Wednesday afternoons. And the frustration of this group, I still have a you know, image-like memory of this. What does that mean, and why? Why would they not let us, and who are us, and who are they? And all kinds of questions come from, in a sense, realizing that a certain identity you have, a certain feature you have, has a contingency attached to it, something you have to deal with in that time and in that place because you have an identity, a feature. That makes that rise to the level of identity. I'll just read something here that I think will kind of flesh out this idea. When I encountered my swimming pool restriction, this segregation of the day that many African Americans of my age will remember, it mystified me. Where did it come from? Conditions of life tied to identity like that still mystify me, but now I have a working idea about where they come from. They come from the way a society at a given time is organized around an identity like race. That organization reflects the history of a place as well as the ongoing struggle for, individual and group competition for opportunity and the good life. The way Chicagoland, where I experienced these things, happened, the way Chicagoland was organized around race in the late 1950s and early 1960s, the rigid housing segregation, the de facto school segregation, the employment discrimination, and so on, meant that black people in that time and place had many restrictive conditions of life tied to their identity, perhaps the least of which was the Wednesday afternoon swimming restriction that so worried my 7 or 8 year old self. This research is about what my colleagues and I call identity contingencies, the things you have to deal with in a situation because you have a given social identity, because you are old, young, gay, a white male, a woman, black, Latino, politically conservative or liberal, diagnosed with bipolar disorder, a cancer patient, and so on. So I'm trying to, with this kind of argument, root social identities in something that's central to how our functioning is organized. I'm trying to root it in the circumstances and the conditions of our lives. I don't think, as individuals, we're independent of those things. Well, an important social contingency or identity contingency is a stereotype threat. The segregations of my youth are concrete and contingencies that are down on the ground and very easy to see. Something like stereotype threat, I'm going to argue, is an equally important contingency of identity, but it's much more abstract and Delphic and hard to appreciate its impact on our functioning and the like. And that really is what this program of research has tried to do, is to take this idea, this contingency, and to explore its impact on our functioning. The definition of stereotype threat is very simple. It's just being in a situation or doing something for which a negative stereotype about one of our identities is relevant. Whenever that happens, we know that we could be judged or treated in terms of that negative stereotype, and if we care about what we're doing, the prospect of being judged and treated that way is upsetting and disturbing and distracting and can even affect us right there in the immediate situation. And that's how something like a belief structure in a society can impose a contingency on a person that affects their psychological functioning. Our first attempt to test this had to do, I can give all kinds of everyday examples that have nothing to do with race and or gender, and probably it's worth doing one. I remember very vividly from being the chair of the psychology department at Stanford, and in the middle of my term as the chair, the department got moved from reporting to a social science dean to reporting to a natural science dean. And all of a sudden, as I began to meet with this new dean, I noticed that I was explaining psychology and making the case for psychology in terms of its hardest edges. You know, we're a big science. We use MRI machines now, and we're really a neuroscience, actually. And as you know, I'm a social psychologist. We're not big science. We don't do those things. And so after several meetings, you know, I began to, well, why am I behaving this way? Why am I representing the field in this way to this dean? And I guess my best excuse for myself is that I was experiencing a form of stereotype threat. It wasn't a negative stereotype about my race or my age or my gender. It was a stereotype about my discipline. I was afraid, perhaps, that this chemist who was a dean would think of psychology compared to the other natural sciences as perhaps a little squishy and maybe not as deserving of resources. And so before he ever said anything, he never said anything to that effect, I found myself countering that allegation, that threat in the air, that stereotype in the air. The title Whistling Vivaldi comes from a story by Brent Staples, who's an African-American editorialist for the New York Times. And he describes going to graduate school in psychology at the University of Chicago in the early 70s and walking down the street dressed as a student, a pretty big guy, and finding that whites on the street were made nervous by his presence. They kind of avoided eye contact. They maybe even moved to the other side of the street. And so he realized that he was being seen through the lens of a racial stereotype and as, you know, possibly menacing. And so he suffered this discomfort, but accidentally after a while learned that if he whistled going down the street, in particular if he whistled Beatles tunes and whistled Vivaldi, he would deflect this stereotype. They would relax, he would relax, and he would go down the street. Now, it's quite a burden to whistle Vivaldi all day, and I haven't met many people that can do that. But could the same threat affect women's math performance and be a factor in their underperformance in these advanced math classes? One of the first studies we ever did was to bring women and men, really good math students, into the laboratory one at a time, and we gave them a half-hour section of the graduate record exam in math, the section you take if you are a math major. And our idea was that because of stereotype threat, if it was real, if it was a true thing, that situation would be very different for a woman than it would be for a man. For a man, his frustration would signal that maybe he doesn't have quite the skill or ability that he'd like to have, and if he cares about math, that could be upsetting and so on. But for a woman, in addition to that concern, she'd have the concern that she is perhaps confirming this negative, this sort of Larry Summers stereotype, that women may lack ability in math in the high end, I think, if I'm quoting him correctly. And so there's that added pressure on their performance in this situation. If there's added pressure on their performance, they should indeed perform less well than the men. And sure enough, they did. Dramatically so. A full standard deviation worse. I think I do actually have these data here. That's what it looked like. Very dramatic difference in performance. The low bar is where the women performed, the high bar is where the men performed, and it's important to stress that these were men and women who we matched very carefully for their math skills coming into this situation. Prior grades and earlier test scores and the like matched them. This still doesn't prove stereotype threat. Larry Summers might argue that, well, you've just discovered the biological explanation here, that it manifests itself, this biological difference between men and women maybe manifests itself when math is difficult, and that's all you're seeing, Claude. Don't make a big deal out of it. So we had to separate our explanation that underperformance was caused by a stereotype threat from the standard explanation that maybe it reflected a genetic difference. And we did that in a very simple way. We simply told everybody, the men and the women, just before they took exactly the same math test, that you might have heard that women don't do as well as men on difficult standardized tests. You might have heard that, but that's not true for this particular test. Not the test you're taking today. Women always do as well as men on this test. So anything, you know, the subtext goes on. Anything that you, frustration you experience isn't reflecting anything about your being a woman. So as soon as we did that, here's what happened to the performance. Women's performance went up quite dramatically. Under that instruction, their frustration can't be taken as a signal that they are confirming this negative stereotype about their ability. And without that pressure and the distraction that that causes, suppressing their performance goes up dramatically to match that of equally skilled men taking the same test. Well, then we went on, we did the same thing with race. I'm not going to detail these experiments in detail, but a simple thing, you give African Americans and white college students the Ravens Progressive Matrices exam. You allow them to think that it's a test of their intelligence. You either say nothing or you explicitly say it's an IQ test. You find that African American college students score a full, in these samples, a full standard deviation lower than white students. You tell them that the same test is just a puzzle. It's not a test that can measure cognitive abilities. It has no ability to measure cognitive abilities. It's just a puzzle. And you know, you can do that with the Ravens Progressive Matrices because they are these kind of figures you have to analyze. You can present it as a puzzle, and when you do that, African Americans' IQ scores match those of white college students. Again, the pressure is similar. When an African American takes a difficult, frustrating IQ test, a test that gets more and more difficult, that frustration signals the possible relevance of that stereotype about his or her group's intellectual abilities. And that, our argument is, causes a huge effort to resist the stereotype, to refute the stereotype, to argue that it isn't relevant to them, to disprove the stereotype, and all of that activity is taking psychological cognitive resources away from performing on the test, and the performance on the test comes down. Well, we've done this now to make the point with all kinds of groups, and fortunately, a great many investigators around the world have looked at stereotype threat of effects of a variety of sorts. You can put white males taking a difficult math test under stereotype threat by just telling them before they take the test that this is a test on which Asians tend to do better than whites. Do the best you can. They, under that instruction, are under the negative pressure of another group's positive stereotype. That causes the same distraction that goes on, the same rumination that goes on with resisting the stereotype, and it interferes with their performance. Over the years, we have a good image of how it is mediated. When you do these experiments and measure physiological reactions and brain reactions at the same time, you find all kinds of disturbances. Almost every indicator of cardiac reactivity is affected by being under stereotype threat, by taking a test, a difficult test, math test as a woman, or a difficult intelligence test as an African American, groups where the stereotypes about their group are negative and apply and could be confirmed in that situation. There are these huge physiological reactions. And interestingly, psychologically, there's very little awareness of it, very little ability to report extra anxiety reactions, even as you are measuring and seeing very clearly that there are these huge physiological reactions going on in the situation. So we have a good sense of that. It causes a kind of overload. The effect is strongest for this is one of the unexpected lessons from this research, almost an irony of it. It is strongest for the members of the group who have the strongest skills and the strongest commitment to doing well in the area where the stereotype applies. What makes you vulnerable to the stereotype is not so much what we might have thought initially, sort of lower self-esteem or lower expectancies or lower confidence in the situation. That's not it. The effect is much stronger for example, women in math, for women who care a lot about doing well in math, have invested in doing well in math, for women that don't care so much about this, then the prospect of confirming that stereotype isn't so important because the whole domain is not that important to them. What makes a person vulnerable to stereotype threat is being identified with and caring about the domain where your group is negative, of performance, where your group is negatively stereotyped. That's the sort of bedrock psychology of it. Well, what makes it weak and what makes it strong? And this is on the way to some ideas about remedy. And if I have, I think in my remaining 6 minutes, I'm going to try to cover all that. Well, it isn't, what makes it weak and strong isn't so much the interior psychology as it is the circumstances, the cues in the situation that suggest there may be contingencies tied to this. If I had time, I'd read a story I captured in this book from the experience of Sandra Day O'Connor on the Supreme Court. She describes her initial years on the court as a sole woman. She uses the term asphyxiating, that she's felt asphyxiated by the attention she got. Everybody scrutinized her decisions. She got phone calls from reporters. They would follow her into restaurants. Was she smart enough? Was she wise enough? Was she a feminist? Was she not feminist enough? All this attention, all these contingencies tied to her being a woman, the only woman on the Supreme Court. Then an interviewer asked her what her experience was when Ruth Bader Ginsburg got there, and she said, it was just night and day. I was no longer the only woman on the Supreme Court. There were two women on the Supreme Court, and we were rather different people. And so it didn't make sense for them to follow me around in the same way. And so my in my terms, all the contingencies tied to being a woman on the Supreme Court changed. And she said she felt normal and like gender made relatively little difference after the arrival of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. I think it's an interesting story because it's a real profound demonstration of the importance of context on her feelings in this situation. The arrival of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, I'm going to argue, is the arrival of critical mass. It's now a critical mass of women on the Supreme Court. And that makes a difference because it changes the contingencies that a person has in that situation. When I first heard this interview, it was before the decisions on the Michigan affirmative action cases were made. But when I heard this interview, I thought, how those decisions were going to be made because Sandra Day O'Connor, as you may remember, was the swing justice on those decisions. And I knew from this interview that at least intuitively, she understood the impact of critical mass on psychological and intellectual functioning. She understood that, and that was the basis for University of Michigan's defense of affirmative action, that you had to have a critical mass in the context, in the social context, to allow minority students to be relaxed enough and able to focus enough to excel academically. Being under identity threat is like having a snake loose in the house. I think that's a good image for it. You don't know if it's ever going to come to anything. You don't know what would happen. You don't know where it would happen. You don't know when it would happen. But you can't quite relax because something could happen. And you need some assurance that something isn't likely to happen. You need some signs that help you downgrade the probability that something bad would happen to you based on having that identity. That's what the experience is like. That's what I want to argue. Now, I want to get as fast as I can to remedies and try to give you some encouraging news to end with. I think there are two things you can do about it. One thing you can do is to do as best you can to correct the cues in a situation so that they don't suggest threatening contingencies to minorities or to people whose abilities are negatively stereotyped. In the math department at Stanford, for example, you had to walk, a woman student would walk in the front door and have to walk down a long hallway of pictures of famous mathematicians, and they would, of course, all be male, and then she would find that the only bathroom available in the room was one woman's bathroom down in the basement of the building, and this would go on and on, and then the examples in the class would be examples that had to do with baseball and probability, and And so it begins to create a set of cues in that environment that signal, I better be vigilant here. That signals to some part of our brain that we have to be vigilant in that situation. That takes effort, and it drains effort, cognitive resources away from performing in this situation. It's as simple as that. So one thing that you have to do, I think, is to dampen or eliminate as many of these cues as you possibly can. You can't eliminate them all. I think of myself in graduate school. I went, as was the experience, I think, of many African Americans who got to that level in the days that I went to graduate school. I was the only African American in the psychology department at Ohio State at the time. There was a professor down the hall who still used the N-word when he wanted to. There were, the whole place was about intelligence, and psychology at the time was really preoccupied about these genetic interpretation of racial differences in IQ, and there I was, sort of exhibit A of the group who was under suspicion about these things. And you're supposed to, sort of out of being a good scientist, just ignore all that stuff and be comfortable in that situation. So I wasn't. I found it a painful situation. But in time, I got a good relationship with my advisor. The heart of that relationship, I think, was that he just kind of took me seriously as a student, which, as you all know, is like just so valuable to be taken seriously. I could tell that he believed I could do this work, and he expected me to do this work, and he demanded a huge amount out of me. And he was supportive. He affirmed my ability to do the work. And in that kind of in the context of that relationship, we began to get things done. Progress started to happen. And all of a sudden, or not all of a sudden, but gradually, the same cues that had been extremely upsetting before weren't so upsetting now. I had some perception, some intuitive perception, that there was going to be room for me in this profession, and that I could do work, and that I could get it fairly responded to, and I started to feel at least a greater margin of safety. I can't think of a better word than that, of sort of identity safety in the situation. Well, Greg Walton and Jeff Cohen are two social psychologists who actually put this to test. They did an experiment. I'm going to simplify the procedures for the sake of time. But they got, this was at an Ivy League university, they got freshmen, black and white students, to watch a 40-minute videotape of a student, an African-American student, who was just 18 months ahead of them at school. And that videotape is a narrative of this older student's experience at that school. And the narrative begins by acknowledging how upset and stressed he was initially, and he just felt like he could never belong and never conform, never fit in. But his father insisted that he come back, because he'd go home on the weekends all the time, and insisted that he come back, and he formed a singing group with a friend, and the singing group started to sing at department colloquia, and in that context he started to hear some really interesting talks, and he heard this amazing talk about biology that was just incredible, and then he heard another incredible talk in sociology, and he started taking courses in these areas, and he can't believe how great this school is and how much it offers and what a wonderful situation it is. So what they're hearing from somebody who they'd listen to, they won't listen to older people. They listen to people who are roughly their age and just a little ahead of them. What they hear is a narrative about this situation that appraises the situation differently than they might otherwise be left to appraise it. It appraises it in a way that says, look, it may be stressful at the outset, that's normal, but look, you're going to relax after a while, and there are going to be some amazing resources and experiences that you can have in this situation. Okay. The next semester, the grades of the African-American students improved by a third of a letter grade. That was the first paper they published in Science based on this study. The second paper followed these people for 3 years, these students for 3 years, and found that at the end of that 3-year period of time, there was absolutely no underperformance of the sort that you saw at the outset of the talk. That being exposed to that 40-minute videotape in their freshman year, this is what's so, I know this is going to strain your credulity here, But seeing that 40-minute videotape in the beginning of their freshman year had an impact 3 years later. Now, how could that be? Well, I think first you have to understand what the African-American students are being blanketed by. They're being blanketed by a sense of identity apprehension in that situation. That what does it mean here? How are people going to respond to me? How will I be taken? And that makes them vigilant in this situation. It is like there's the snake loose in the house. What's going to happen? And so they need some sense, some understanding that will reduce the anxiety related to around that. Very much like the narrative that I eventually came to in graduate school. It's like, yeah, there are these things here that are not so good, but there are some other things here that are very good and that I will be able to succeed at. So they get that narrative almost injected into them by listening to this videotape of this student who's a little bit older to them. And with that narrative in hand, they start to relax, they do better, and then as they do better, the narrative strengthens, the sense of threat weakens, the sense of safety in the situation increases, they do better still, and you launch a kind of positive recursive process. As opposed to a negative recursive process, which you can imagine might have happened and did happen in the control conditions where students weren't treated or weren't seen, weren't shown this simple videotape. But that was enough because it targeted precisely what the problem was for these students. These students didn't lack skills. They didn't lack that. What they lacked was a sense of safety in the environment. And what this narrative that they were given enabled them to have was an increased sense of safety there. Well, I just want to end by saying that there are now an accumulation of these interventions like this. Well, you might ask the question, what would happen if you tried to modify school experience or experience in the workplace, if you tried to modify it in ways that would reduce stereotype threat, social identity threat, that would reduce those things. Would those things have an impact? Would it have a real impact in the real world? Is this process something that's important in the real world? Well, now there have been an accumulation of enough of those interventions. I'm not going to have a chance to describe them all to you, but you can read them in chapter 9 of that book that's ending with a hook here. But there's an accumulation of enough of these things that a meta-analysis was published last year in Psych Science showing something really interesting, that not only do these interventions eliminate underperformance, but they produce a kind of overperformance. This last slide that you see in front of you is an example of this. I apologize because you're not going to see the legends here. But that top line, that black line, the solid black line, is the line as the one I showed you at the outset of the talk, it's for all students. That top line is for African-American students who were in programs that tried to relieve stereotype threat and identity threat. And in this instance, what you can see is that they're performing slightly better than other students with their same SAT scores and entering ACT scores. So these data, to me, almost as much as anything, give me some sense that these processes are important in real-life situations like performance in academic context, performance in work context. There are myriads of ways that stereotype threat and group identity threat and the sort affect us in interpersonal relationships, our ability to trust each other, our ability to be comfortable around each other. So much of this has to do with a sense of being under the threat of being stereotyped in terms of ways that we know our group is seen in this way, and by God, I'm in a situation where I could be seen this way, and it introduces another set of concerns that can be disruptive. I think what's impressive to me, and this is what I'll end on, is the notion that in real-world academic settings, these processes are not just a small part of the problem, but they're turning out to be a major part of the problem. So with that, I'll thank you and stop. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Steele. I have one other person that I want to acknowledge tonight. We learned just a few couple of weeks ago that Dr. Patrick DeLeon, a former APA president, will be retiring after nearly 40 years of service in the United States Senate as a key senior staff member to Senator Daniel Inouye of Hawaii. I could not end this program without taking this opportunity to acknowledge Pat for his many contributions to federal policy development over the years. Pat's legislative skills and accomplishments have led to greater opportunities and improved quality of life for millions of Americans. In addition, his efforts have resulted in expanded opportunities for psychology practice, for example, through prescription privileges and Medicare, increased support for the graduate psychology education program, heightened recognition for psychological science in legislation, and at federal agencies and public policies that help meet the needs of underserved populations, including children, women, ethnic minorities, and older adults. Early on in his career, Pat recognized the value of psychologists and other non-physician providers for enhancing consumer choice and quality of care. I do not believe that Pat has ever encountered an obstacle that he could not surmount. He is a true visionary and trailblazer who has received two presidential citations in recognition of his many accomplishments. Pat was among the first to appreciate the unique contributions of psychology for the legal system and the public policy process. This led him to advocate for the creation of APA's Committee on Legal Issues and for APA to be among the first scientific societies to establish a Congressional Science Fellowship program to enable psychologists to gain direct policy experience on Capitol Hill. Pat is also a prolific writer and has served as the editor of many of our APA journals. In so doing, he opened doors for many others to participate in this vital process, including ethnic minorities and women. Pat, your dedication, commitment, and tireless efforts advocating for psychology and for those we serve are admirable and absolutely unparalleled. You have walked the walk, and it's been a privilege to be there alongside you. The hundreds of us whom you have mentored and the profession of psychology owe you a profound debt of gratitude. I'm delighted that the Board of Directors will be hosting an event in the fall to honor you for your public service in the Senate, but those of us here today would now like to publicly acknowledge you for your outstanding career as a public servant and for your invaluable contributions to APA and the field of psychology. Would you please stand, Dr. DeLeon? I want to thank the APA staff responsible for helping with this event tonight. They put in numerous hours of commitment, and they do an excellent job. And I want to thank all of you for coming this evening, and I hope you have a memorable convention. Don't forget that you can purchase Dr. Steele's book and Funkadesi's CDs at the back of the auditorium. And Funkadesi is going to play for us, and so you may remain as long as you want to listen to them. Thank you very much.